In ecological economics, decoupling refers to the separation of economic value creation from extraction and pollution. There isn't one measure of decoupling, but rather different measures for different types of extraction or pollution. We look at decoupling of greenhouse gas emissions from GDP in order to judge whether economic growth is compatible with limited global warming. For a more general indicator on other ecological barriers, we use material throughput as a proxy for ecological damage and measure if this can be decoupled from growth. We normally measure decoupling by looking at the effect of GDP growth on the rate of extraction or pollution. This is easier to measure and understand, but it is important to remember that there is an ecological limit on the total amount of extraction or pollution, rather than the rate. I.e., it doesn't matter if we emit less and less pollution each year, if the cumulative emissions will overshoot some limit. If the economy grows and extraction or pollution remain constant or decrease, we call this absolute decoupling. If the economy grows and extraction or pollution grow, but by less than economic growth, we call this relative decoupling. The extent to which decoupling is possible forms a key part of the debate between advocates for degrowth and advocates for green growth. It is important to note that the bar is very high. In order to argue that green growth is possible, it is not enough to show that there has been relative decoupling, or even low levels of absolute decoupling. To show that we can avoid ecological disaster while maintaining GDP growth, one must show a significant long-term absolute decoupling. Finally, it is important to measure the amount of ecologically damaging goods consumed within a country, rather than produced by that country. Because otherwise one finds a misleading relationship where wealthy countries export most of their ecological footprint, i.e. they import a lot of goods which cause a lot of damage when they're produced, but in the other countries where they're produced. Decoupling greenhouse gas emissions. For greenhouse gas emissions, there has been global relative decoupling and absolute decoupling in the US and EU. This is true both for production and consumption-led measures. So, while these countries do still export a large portion of their carbon footprint, their emissions have been decreasing, even taking this into account. However, increases in carbon productivity have been slowing down rather than increasing. Based on current trends, around 4.2 degrees by 2100 is expected. While if all countries met their obligations under the Paris Agreement, this would lead to roughly 3.3 degrees. We can look at the scenarios for below 2 degrees warming in the IPCC's 5th assessment report for some indications of potential future paths compatible with green growth. 110 of the 116 scenarios depend on carbon sequestering, a highly speculative technology which may not be possible at anywhere near the required scale. 101 of these require carbon sequestering to the level of achieving negative emissions, an even more ambitious target for the technology. The remaining 6 scenarios assume optimal technology in all other areas, along with afforestation. Another scenario suggested by the IPCC Special Report on 1.5 degrees Celsius, known as low energy demand, is more plausible, requiring decarbonization and afforestation, as well as 40% energy reduction by 2050, shifting away from private ownership of key commodities, a 42% decline in industry in the global north, and a 12% decline in the south. This scenario is nominally a green growth scenario, but estimates GDP growth using only labor, supply, and energy, and further assumes massive improvements in energy efficiency. This seems implausible when comparing it with current and projected rates of decoupling. Green growth of 3% per year, compatible with a 1.5 to 2 degree target, would require a global decoupling rate of 7.3% to 10.5% respectively. And if developing countries are allowed some minor room to increase emissions before aggressive reductions after 2025 under common but differentiated responsibility, then wealthy nations must decouple by at least 15%. However, the best case projected decoupling is around 4%, including high subsidies for renewables and high taxes on fossil fuel and gas. Decoupling everything else. Have we reached peak stuff? To examine a broader set of ecological boundaries, we can use total material throughput as a proxy for environmental degradation. At an aggregate level, there is a high degree of correlation between material throughput and ecological impact. there is much less decoupling of material throughput in GDP than for greenhouse gas emissions in GDP. Historically, there has been global relative decoupling, but not in the 21st century. And nationally, only China, India, and South Africa show even relative decoupling using consumption-based measures. In terms of materials used in national production, measured by direct material consumption, DMC, some wealthy countries have dematerialized. However, this trend is reversed if we take the consumption-based measure, material footprint, MF, which takes into account imports. Economic theory and decoupling. This is all very well in practice, but does it work in theory? Theoretically, GDP is just a measure of what people are willing to pay for. So we could imagine a society where people change their preferences to favor more environmentally friendly goods. At its extreme, we could imagine a society where people are willing to pay very highly for nature preservation. Here, GDP is entirely unlimited by ecological barriers. But to call this green growth would be to obscure the actual trajectory of production, which this term is used to argue for. Finally, one could argue that some unforeseen vast improvement in efficiency will allow decoupling. There are two problems here. First, there is little or no theoretical empirical basis suggesting a high enough rate of efficiency improvements are possible. Secondly, efficiency does not decrease consumption. Capitalist economies grow by using resources more productively. For example, labor productivity increases lead to more employment. Why would we assume that this worked differently for other resources? One could argue that degrowth itself is a very speculative view of the future, predicated on massive socio-political change. What differentiates this from the change needed for green growth? The laws governing political economy are, after all, fundamental and unchanging constants of the universe. In comparison, physical, chemical, and biological limits can be disregarded through relatively trivial acts of engineering. This is going to be the first on a whole series on degrowth, so please subscribe if you want to see more videos like this in the future. Also, please like and comment this video.